Good evening, everyone. Thank you very much for attending tonight. My name is Elizabeth Ho and I'm Director of the Hawke Centre here at the University of South Australia. I'd like to welcome you here tonight on behalf of the University and our centre, the Hawke Centre, and also Amnesty International. You're here to listen to the Honourable Robyn Layton, who will be speaking on empowering poor communities, good practices. This event is being held during Anti-Poverty Week, and it's also happening on the UN International Day for the Eradication of Poverty. We've been very pleased to support this important campaign against poverty. We have details of the week on our website, and we encourage you to go and have a look at what has been happening and maybe plan something for next year if you're not involved this year. I'm really very, very pleased that we have a very important and special person with us tonight, and that is our lovely Auntie Josie. And Auntie Josie is going to give us the Kaurna welcome as an elder of the Kaurna people. Thank you.
Hello, everyone. Nina Marnie. Puliana miyuna pindi miyuna kuma. Martin Younger Kaurna miyuna nai wangni mani na budni. Tapatla Portugana yutanga yuandi. Mani nadlu yata yatapandi. Natalu Minga Mana Nindi Buki on a co. Natalu Minga Mana Nindi Buki on a co. Natha Padiadu Maranga Puliana Miuna Pindi Miuna Kuma. Padiadi Wadu. Ladies and gentlemen, on behalf of the Kaurna elders, past and present, and the Kaurna people, I'd like to welcome you here tonight on the Kaurna land, and it's important that we recognise this. And tonight is a very special night, and a special welcome to all the people here tonight, especially visitors from wherever. I hope you're going to enjoy yourself tonight, because you've got some good speakers here tonight, and I think it's important when we can talk about different things, because, you know, in Adelaide now and other places, we have all sorts of different cultured people around, you know, and I think we all got to come together sometimes, and we don't do that very often, to talk about different things and mix with each other. And I think sometimes it would be nice for us to do that, but we don't do that very much. I'm not sure why. And that, but you know, just to say hello to each other would be nice now and again. So, and smile at each other. Because, you know, with us, with the traditional people, we if we don't know each other, we just nod to each other in recognition of each other. And that's, so that's one of the good things. So tonight, you're going to hear some of the people and the way that they're going to be talking about it. And especially one lady who's come from the Yorta Yorta land. And I'm glad she's here tonight, and I hope she enjoys herself and that. So I'll just say, I'll knock on you all later because I've got to go. Okay, good night.
Auntie Josie always says something that makes you feel good. And she's done it again. I'd just like to mention how important Kaurna elders have been to us at the Hawke Centre. They've helped us with our gallery, which celebrates the place of the red kangaroo. And we pay our respects to the Kaurna elders and indeed all Kaurna people and recognise their connection to country. Here at the Hawke Centre, we offer a year-long program to encourage people to think, connect and act. And especially in spheres where we really need social improvement, we need to exercise a conscience about improving the lot of others. And tonight is no exception. We're very pleased to be co-presenting with Amnesty International. I particularly want to thank Denise Skiffington, the South Australian Northern Territory President, for her major contribution to helping this evening. We will be reflecting the Amnesty message again at our event on the 14th of November with Just Sustainability Australia. They were able to fund our speaker, Dr. Alice Aruhita Pollard, who comes from the Solomon Islands. This was, as I said, funded through an Amnesty International grant, and more information is available about that event on our website. We are recording the session tonight. There will be a podcast of the event available on the Hawke Centre website by the end of the week. We encourage you to encourage others to have a look at what was said tonight if they couldn't be here. We would also be very grateful if you could turn the mobile phones off so that it doesn't interrupt the recording. And a video will be available on our Hawke Centre YouTube later this month. There are a few people here that I'd like to particularly thank for attending, and they are Tony Piccolo, Member for Light, who is representing the Premier this evening, Ms. Gay Thompson, Member for Rennell, the Honourable Chris Caracas, Chief Justice of the Supreme Court, Professor Loitra O'Donoghue, our esteemed Hawke Centre patron, and of course, one of the foremost leaders of Aboriginal people in Australia in our history. Thank you, Loitra. Stephen Gillis, the Acting CEO for Anglicare South Australia, Professor Peter Buckskin, Dean of Indigenous Scholarship Engagement and Research at UniSA, Michael O'Connell, SA Commissioner for Victims' Rights, and our distinguished speaker, Robyn Layton, who will be introduced more fully shortly. I'd now like to hand over, with great pleasure, to Monica Morgan. Monica is Manager of Indigenous Peoples' Rights with Amnesty International, and she will introduce Robyn. Monica is a Yorta Yorta woman from Victoria and has been with Amnesty for the last 4 years. Thank you, Monica.
Namani, welcome. It's absolutely a privilege for me to come across here to Kaurna country to not only welcome our guest speaker, but also speak on the work of Amnesty International. As a Yorta Yorta woman who has been part of the struggle and witnessed many of what our elders here in the audience and friends have been experiencing, the plight or the history that has surrounded Australia and its invasion of the lands of Indigenous peoples, Aboriginal and Torres Strait Islanders, has been vexed with a lot of controversy and a lot of ill-conceived processes and practices. And I'm very pleased to hear tonight that we'll be listening to those kind of examples and processes by which we can start hearing and changing the discourse around how we address people who are under the yoke of oppression and poverty. Firstly, what I'd like to do before I introduce Robyn is that just to give you a little bit of background on who makes up the world in relation to poverty. And not only does Australia have Aboriginal and Torres Strait Islander peoples who are the most disadvantaged when it comes to land holdings, when it comes to statistics for incarceration rates, for education, for health, the whole raft of those disadvantages that come about because of denial of rights to country and the economy within this country, is that Indigenous peoples are around 350 million. And many of the Indigenous peoples live in very many of those countries that are looked at as third world. But also many of the Indigenous peoples live within very wealthy countries, such as United States, Canada, New Zealand and Australia. Amnesty, I'm very, very proud of the work that we've been doing recently in relation to the Homelands campaign. We have information and literature out there for you. What's been happening is the policies and processes of assimilation that has been perpetrated on people, in Aboriginal and Torres Strait Islander peoples, is due to the ill-conceived idea that to be rich within this westernised country is to work and to live and behave as non-Indigenous peoples. This falls in the face of what has been going on in the United Nations just recently. And what you will find out there is the Declaration on the Rights of Indigenous Peoples. Predominantly, the rights of Indigenous peoples are based on self-determination. It's based on free prior informed consent. It's based on a free and equal distribution of wealth that has come out of the lands in which people have been able to derive, these new generations of people have been derived a living. In the homelands, we've got 500 communities that have, in Northern Territory, since the Land Rights Act, have been able to move back to country. They have been able to retain laws, customs and traditions that are the basis of identity, that is a basis of not only an economic economy that we believe can be derived from there, but also a cultural economy. And with tonight's talk, I hand over to the Honourable Robyn Layton. I understand that Robyn has been a former judge with the Supreme Court of South Australia, a renowned development consultant, and she will tonight address us with marking the Anti-Poverty Week of 2012. I also think it's a privilege that Amnesty have been able to work together with the Bob Hawke Centre in being able to deliver tonight this symposium or this oration. And Robyn is going to speak on the empowering of poor communities and good practice. She has a multitude of background. She's worked with Aboriginal communities and is currently working with communities leading Asia Development Bank on Poverty and Reduction project for women in the Philippines, Cambodia and Kazakhstan. And she continues her work with the Labor Office, providing judicial education on human rights and international labor standards in various countries. I also understand that part of her roles that she does voluntary, she's also co-chair of the South Australian Reconciliation. It is with great pleasure that I bring Robyn to the podium, and also would ask at the end of the night that you sign this action, which is a letter of solidarity to the women of Utopia, because tonight's oration is about women. And we know that Aboriginal women have a double-edged sword to deal with. Not only discrimination and the denial of rights as an Indigenous person, but also the sexual discrimination that's afforded not just to women everywhere in the world, but most particularly to Aboriginal women. We have had to endure in the Northern Territory the army introduced policies and introduced practice that flies in the face of good policy. And I'm hoping tonight that we will hear some really good antidotes and advice about how that should happen. So I bring to the podium Robyn, and I thank you very much. And it's a privilege to hear tonight.
Well, thank you for that very generous introduction. I didn't actually realise that I was such an expert in gender development and development work. That's relatively brought together a number of experiences that I've been involved in for some years, but more recently as a team leader for the Asian Development Bank. So I'm bringing together a whole number of things. Before I start, I wish to acknowledge that we meet on the land of the Kaurna people, and I wish to acknowledge and pay respect to elders past and present, and also to acknowledge how important country is to Aboriginal people, both in the past and in the present time, and that was made manifest by what Monica has also said today already. So, empowering communities' good practices. I, in particular, want to focus on good practice. Often with poverty reduction, we don't hear about good practice, we just see what the numbers are like. But there is movement around the world, and in particular in developing countries, where there has been an improvement of strategies, in particular in the Asia-Pacific area, but what is still lacking is in the African sub-Sahara area. That's where the poverty still continues. But as we all know, poverty is not just caused by individual circumstances, but it's by major inequalities that are built into the actual structure of society. We know what the causes are. On the whole, it's lack of access to work, education, housing, and services. We also know it's a relative concept and that it has a multi-dimension. But it includes not only physical or material things, it also includes human resources, such as deprivation of choice and power. Poverty of itself is a violation of human rights, but also poverty brings about further human rights violations, and anti-discrimination or non-discrimination and equality are some of the real issues. We know poverty exists across all countries, developed and undeveloped. In developing countries, it's usually widespread, whereas in countries such as ourselves, it tends to be in regions or pockets of disadvantage. We've heard many figures this week on the poverty statistics in Australia. I'll just bring a few which are going to be relevant to what I talk about. The number of people living in poverty in Australia is estimated to be 2.2 million at the present time, and it has increased. And in Australia, with regard to ABS statistics, on the whole, that relates only to the 2006 statistics. The 2010 have not yet been evaluated. So we're not really getting up with the most up-to-date sex and other disaggregated statistics in Australia. However, we do know that Australian sole parents are the highest, and mostly those are women, and that's roughly 70%. Single people aged over the age of 65, another huge figure. With regard to Indigenous people, half of Indigenous people over the age of 14 have lived or are living in a household where they couldn't raise more than $2,000 within a week in an emergency, and that's one of the indicators of poverty, compared with 13% of non-Aboriginal people. That's relevant for something that I'll talk about in a moment. Of particular relevance is the increase in child poverty. In 2006, there were 500,000. At that same time, 105,000 people were homeless, and a quarter of those were teenagers. The United Nations International Children's Emergency Fund has concluded that countries that spend more on social security payments have lower rates of child poverty. In 2007, Australia spent 4.3% of its national GDP on income support, which was below the OECD average of 6.4. So coming now to poverty strategies. By very definition, they're aimed at reducing poverty. And those strategies depend on bringing together two things. One is macroeconomic policies, as well as a human rights framework. When I talk about macroeconomic policies, what is happening increasingly is that economists and politicians, and also business generally, are recognising that in order to bring about long-term poverty reduction, there needs to be an insurance for economic growth which is inclusive. So that term, inclusive economic growth, refers to the fact that there's a need to ensure that whatever growth occurs in a country just doesn't make the rich richer, but is also distributed amongst the poorer. And of those, women are usually the poorest of the poor, and in certainly indigenous populations are even at the lower end, and most of those are also even poorer so far as women are concerned. Some of those economic, macroeconomic policies also have similarities with the human rights framework. And a human rights framework and poverty reduction includes a right to health, education, live a life with respect and dignity, and entitlement that those rights be able to be exercised in a non-discriminatory and sharing equally. There are also some additional rights that flow, and these are particularly important with regard to poverty reduction. They are the rights to participation and inclusion, and the rights for accountability and transparency in obtaining those rights. So what does that mean? Participation and inclusion refers to the rights of poor people to be able to participate in decisions about the design, implementation, and monitoring of poverty reduction interventions and programs. They should be given a voice at all stages. Also, accountability and transparency. There is a need to monitor and evaluate poverties that are policies that are meant to be poverty reduction strategies, so that they can be either adjusted or replicated. So where does community fit in? In order to achieve those goals, it is necessary for there to be a community framework, and that is so whether it's with regard to delivery of essential services in education, health, social protection, or employment. There needs to be a centralised national framework, but at the same time, the services have got to be delivered in a decentralised manner. Poor communities, which are often already, almost by definition, disempowered, shouldn't simply be treated as passive recipients of plans or strategies developed nationally and imposed upon them from above. It's a two-way process. Input into the strategy in the first place and involvement at the end with the way in which they are delivered to ensure that they do in fact change the lives of those they were meant to change. Communities are identified in various ways, but communities often have their own economic, social, and cultural flavour which need to be taken into account. And also, it can be seen that around the world, local government are often taking a greater part than has ever taken place in the past with involvement in poverty reduction strategies. And I think in Australia, that's going to play its own way out as well. As we know, there is going to be a referendum on local government, which will allow the federal government to, in fact, pay monies directly to local government for the purposes of initiatives and strategies. Coming now to good practice, I've encapsulated what I regard as seven basic principles for good practice. And in a nutshell, it's access to information, transparency, participation, identifying the purpose and aim of policy. Sometimes policies don't express what the aim is. So how on earth can you ever find out whether that aim has ever been achieved? They need to have goals, targets, and action plans, which are short, medium, and long term, evaluation, and also to ensure that they actually benefit the communities that they're meant to benefit. The first of my good examples is going to be an illustration from the Philippines, where I've been doing work with the Asian Development Bank. And the Philippines is a very different country from ours. It is developing, or it's a medium-sized economy. They have 104 million, as distinct from our 21, 22 million. They are geographically diverse. They're spread around 7,000 islands. But that place has some of the best articulated policies anywhere in Asia Pacific. They too have a problem with implementation, like every country does, but they've actually got a couple of very good strategies that assist women and have been shown to assist women more importantly. The first one is called the Philippine Plan for Gender Responsive Development, 1995 to 2025. Note that it's a 30-year plan. So it's had a short, medium, and long-term goals. Essentially, what that plan requires is that all government departments incorporate into their programs and services measures to address gender problems. They have a landmark law, which is called the Magna Carta of Women. And in that, there is a comprehensive anti-discrimination provision as well as gender equality law in a general sense. The Act states that the government shall, it's a requirement, provide opportunities for women to enhance and develop their skills, acquire productive employment and contribute to their families and communities to the fullest of their capabilities. After that, there are gender action plans that are actually developed in order to fulfill that. As I said, every government department is to have and does have a gender action plan. At least 5% of the total budget of that department is set aside to develop that plan. And it is actively monitored and assessed through the Philippine Commission of Women. And that commission, in turn, acts as a clearinghouse, a database, does policy studies, monitors and assesses laws as well as programs, and also implements pilot projects. So you can see there is an overall national plan, and that was developed from the ground up and then articulated in that particular way. The Philippines Commission for Women has involved itself in various projects with the Canadian International Development Agency called CEDA, and also AusAid is involved in the implementation and assistance with some of those programs as well. In some ways, I think it's very sad that AusAid is doing great work overseas when some of those things cannot be done actually in our own country. So my first subset example from the Philippines is what is called the Gender Responsive Economic Actions for the Transformation of Women. This is where the Philippines have these things that are this long and then reduce them to a few sentences or less, an acronym. And this is called Great Women. So that's where it all comes from. And the express purpose of that project, and this is the quote, is to foster efficient, responsive, transparent, and accountable governance at all levels, and to support the development of sustainable small and medium enterprises that can create more, better, and decent jobs for women and men. So what does it do? This project is run out in the poorest of the regions of the Philippines, and what it particularly does is that it empowers the growth of women's livelihood activities through micro and also extending beyond micro enterprises. So it brings together partnerships to allow that to happen. So it brings in civil society, private and public sectors, government and local government units, and also at the local level in the cities and municipalities. They collectively are the ones that work together to work out, well, what is the program that is needed here that can best reduce poverty for, in particular, women in that community. Those people are all brought together, and then there is funding to enable them to do that. So that's how it works. So the Great Women Project establishes data baselines for women micro-entrepreneurs and micro-enterprises, provide information dissemination, sets up programs and services according to their need, assists with scaling up enterprises as well, conducts community orientation and information sessions to encourage women's participation. It helps them with developing knowledge products so that they can actually market them, what they're able to produce. And they also provide awards and incentives to local governments with good gender practices. So they work with a carrot approach and work with community. That has been assessed by CEDA, which is the Canadian organisation that assisted them to set up. And what it's found is that those programs have enhanced women's access not only to basic services, but also to credit, information and technology. So it's changing those women's lives in those communities. I'll now move to a different world example, and that is what is called conditional cash transfers, CCTs. These are programs that are specifically designed to reduce poverty by making welfare payments conditional upon welfare recipients taking particular actions. For example, government transfers additional money, and I'm underscoring that for reasons that will be apparent shortly, to persons who meet certain poverty criteria on the condition that those recipients undertake certain actions, and those actions are nominated, such as attending regular checkups for pregnant women, requiring regular school attendance of children, attendance even at parent-teacher meetings, if that be the particular need, compliance with immunisation or other health checkups. So it's very specific money given for a very specific purpose. Typically, the programs transfer the money to women because women on the whole have been found to use money more effectively to help family than money paid to men. And that is certainly true also in Australia. CCTs were first introduced in Latin America, and now they're being used in about 30 countries, mostly developing countries. But they have also recently been introduced into New York and Washington, in particularly disadvantaged communities. I haven't been able to find the outcomes of that, but I can talk about the outcomes generally of those strategies which were developed in Brazil, which have helped 12 million families, and those in Mexico, which have helped more than 5 million families. So it addresses structural poverty and uses a carrot rather than a stick. And it's been found to be highly successful in improving food consumption, increased use of health and education services, has led to beneficial child outcomes, such as reduction in child mortality, better nutrition, and improved education attendance. So I now want to turn to a contrasting situation, not a good example, or one perhaps that looks as though it is probably not going to work out to be a good example because it doesn't have all of the strategies that need to be in place in order to make it one. And that's to talk about the Basic Card Australia and the Basic Card system. And some of you may know about it, some of you may not. It's a compulsory income management program which was initially introduced during the intervention on the lands. And under that program, a certain percentage of Centrelink payments were compulsorily quarantined and put into a basic card. And this money put on the basic card could not be redeemed for cash and could only be used to purchase goods at particular licensed venues, and the goods included food, clothing, health, cleaning, white goods and fuel. The basics card in particular in the territory could not be, was said not to be used for the purchase of alcohol, tobacco, gambling or pornography. Now just pausing there, they're very honourable aims to think that one can reduce it that way, but is quarantining income going to be the way that is done? And that's the question I ask for you, which I'll reinforce in a moment. So following criticisms of that particular strategy in the territory by the United Nations Human Rights Council. The government has now extended that program to include not only the territory, but to also expand it into 5 trial locations, one of which is in South Australia, which is in Playford, and the others are in New South Wales, Queensland, and Victoria. So in these trial locations, and it's only just started this year, I think it was about June this year, there can be, Centrelink payments can be compulsorily placed on the basic card system if a person has either been referred by a government social worker or by a child protection authority. A Centrelink recipient can, however, voluntarily go onto the program. So the essential difference between conditional cash transfers and the basic card system is that conditional cash transfers are optional and additional payments, which are conditional upon certain conditions. The basics card involuntarily takes away payments and restricts discretionary income in quite a way that is so much different from the way in which social security payments are paid out generally around the world. I don't have issues if the basic card system is adopted voluntarily, and there are examples of the Cape York in Queensland and also in Aboriginal communities in the Kimberleys. And I'm assuming that information was appropriately given to them, which meant that they have in fact made an informed choice. However, my concerns are about the involuntary nature of it, and even though there are appeal mechanisms, that in a disadvantaged community, particularly Aboriginal communities, is unlikely ever to be exercised. So my concerns are this: the lack of community consultation with regard to the local government areas in which that's being implemented. What is the quarantining of income designed to achieve? If it's designed to achieve what the name of it is, which is income management, my question is, how is forcibly limiting purchases to particular stores assisting recipients to better manage their money? It appears instead to be a deprivation of income, not a management of income. Also, the compulsory deprivation of income stigmatises basic cardholders. It's demeaning at stores, and this was complained of by Aboriginal communities where they produced their card and were found to have to be moved across to another area so that they could see whether they had enough money in their card to be able to pay for the goods that they'd actually purchased. It restricts rights and takes away, and it doesn't allow money to be accumulated for the purposes of emergency needs. That's what the reason why I was asking you to focus on the inability, in particular of Aboriginal people, to be able to have money to deal with emergency needs. I'm also concerned about the unintended consequences, particularly with regard to Aboriginal women, and in particular with regard to domestic violence. In order to escape from domestic violence, there is often a need to call on emergency money to do so. You can't escape if you've got no money to get away with. So one of the real concerns that I've got is that it will disadvantage women in domestic violence situations, and it may also mean that women do not complain about domestic violence because they fear they might end up on one of these programs. So it could be an unintended effect. So the basic card, in my view, seems to be a naming and shaming and a punitive approach rather than having an inclusive policy as the basis for it. I also question the cost of this. I've seen figures which suggest, and I'm not quoting them because I don't know whether they're accurate, but the cost of in fact running these at the moment on what's appeared in the media appears to be about equal with the cost of, with the outcomes that can be delivered. And that, I think, is an area that needs to be assessed and monitored. Just flowing on from that, and it's just really to refer to what Monica's already referred to in her address earlier, and that's on the Intervention and the Stronger Futures Act, and what impact that is going to have on the utopian people's voice. Amnesty was involved in an excellent report which was done in collaboration with the utopian communities, called The Land Holds Us, and I dare say that's probably outside. What that did, briefly, is identify two things as a result of the research. One is that over 20 years of research confirmed that the people on the utopian homelands are able to maintain cultural identity, live healthier and longer lives than those not on homelands. The second aspect of the report highlighted the effect of what is a combination of the Commonwealth and Northern Territory policies, which is to create 21 hub towns called territory growth towns in the Northern Territory. And these growth towns are going to attract some $700 million for services. Those services will cover 24% of the population of Aboriginal people that live there. However, with regard to the 500 homelands communities, which are 35% of the Aboriginal population, approximately $7 million is to be allocated with regard to them. So what it's doing is producing a great disparity between those on the homelands and those in growth towns. Of course, one would expect that with a hubbing, you would get better services there. That's not the point that I'm making. It's the disparity between the income. So that in fact, those who want to remain and exercise their Indigenous right to remain on their homelands are hardly going to be able to have their existing levels of infrastructure and services kept. That is my concern. I'll now go to a good example, which is this time in a healthy families and children. And this is taken from the District of Columbia in the US, and just briefly, it's this. In the 1980s, disadvantaged children and families were struggling with what we all know in many communities to be the weight of crime, poverty, and a fragmented service delivery system. Community leaders and members of advocacy communities worked together to produce a prevention-based community strategy, which in fact built on the resilience of individuals and communities in order to prevent child maltreatment and to promote child and youth success. So the approach taken wasn't a completely new model, but the partnerships that they developed was a new model. And in particular, a key feature was a collaborative, which was an independent entity, which was composed of community members who in fact determined the services. So that collaborative of community members acted as a bridge between the government with the money and the community being those that got the services. So it also brought around a hubbing of the services so that they were all brought together in a very close proximity. It was getting close to the one-stop shop, which in fact many countries are now trying to develop, particularly in rural areas, a one-stop shop where people don't have to go all over the place to try and get services. They are focused around in roughly the same area. Another example I'm going to use this time from Australia, and it's a new initiative, and it's still being rolled out now, and it's still being assessed now, but there is every chance that this will in fact be a good example within Australia. And it's called the Building Bridges, Building Capacity program. It's a workforce development, and it's flowing from one of the few national frameworks that we do have in Australia that goes over the beyond the length of a political election. And that's a national framework for protecting Australia's children. So what this Building Bridges, Building Capacity does in 12 of the most socially disadvantaged communities in Australia is to have a strategy that brings together the services to try and stop the silos. And a simple example for this purpose is this. If a person goes to an adult service, usually the adults are treated, but there is no reflection on, well, there's an adult who needs drug and alcohol services or mental health services. Do they have any children? And so each of them deal with it separately. So this is bringing it together so that the services start talking to each other. So if an adult does go in, for example, in the for drug addiction or mental health or whatever, there is at the same time a looking at the children in order to try and bring about preventative strategies, not waiting for the time when those children might then turn up on a database as being in need of protection by being named in that particular way. So this is looking to be a very good strategy, and I wish I could point to more in Australia that is actually doing this, bringing the services together better. Another example I'm going to use is in the justice area, and I'll finish with these two examples. One's called problem-solving courts, and you may remember that name, Smart Justice. It was when Peggy Fulton-Hora was in South Australia, and she gave a very good report and made a number of recommendations, which is to set up problem-solving courts. And these are courts which bring together, work within community, and the courts work differently from the usual courts. And I'm going to use one that I actually saw in operation and sat on, actually, with the person that was doing it. And that was a Red Hook Community Justice Centre. That worked in the Brooklyn area, and it worked out of a refurbished Catholic school. And it was devised by the community itself to deal with the needs of the community. And the community needs at that point were to reduce drug use, crime, domestic violence, landlord and tenant disputes. So what a judge did in that particular community was that the judge could deal with all of those, which would normally be dealt with in three or four different courts, in the one court, and then to recommend particular strategies to bring together community restitution, on-site educational workshops, classes, drug treatment, mental health counselling, all of which were actually monitored by the court. So all of the services were surrounding the court. And they also had some very innovative ideas which involved the community themselves. So the community were there when there were being, where there was graffiti and they were painting out the signs and so forth. And we have a bit of that here. But the community were involved actually in monitoring some of those. So there were a number of services delivered within community and monitored by community. So that was, I thought, something that, in particular, Michael Atkinson, when he was then Attorney General, said would be done in the southern areas. Unfortunately, that's been stopped now, so there was the beginning of the work there, but the current Attorney General has brought that to a close, I think partly on economic reasons, and partly he says he wants to see more evidence-based work, which then brings me to my last example, which is justice reinvestment programs, and you're going to be hearing more about this. It works similarly, but it is not just focused on the court. What it is reinvesting monies that would normally be spent on housing people in prisons to instead use that money to deliver services within community, recognising that many of the disadvantaged communities, for a start, have a high crime rate that then lead to people going into prison. And where do those people go when they come out? They go back to the communities in which they're in. This is data-driven. In other words, there's a mapping process which sets out where the needs are. And it's also community-based because it then works with the community to identify what the particular needs are and then work out the service delivery model that is going to develop those needs. So, and deliver those outcomes. So you can see it's working from community out to a broad strategy and then working back from that strategy back into community. And there is a fledgling advocacy group in South Australia, which I'm involved in, that will be starting some of that mapping. So in conclusion, it's important to stress that good practice cannot be identified when the purposes and objectives aren't named and where they are not evaluated and assessed and have that available to the public so we know where our money is being spent. It needs to engage with local communities. There's no point in having a national strategy that doesn't meet the needs of communities, and many don't. And it's no good simply having them imposed on communities. So my final message is poverty strategies require empowerment of communities, and that is the way to do it, and that is the way to have outcomes in the future for poverty reduction in Australia.
Thank you. Thank you very much, Robyn, for a presentation of great depth that's been informed by the work that you've done with communities both here and overseas, and also informed by the great humanity that you bring to the work that you do. We now have time, quite a bit of time, for some questions. We have some roving mics, and so if people could please put up their hands, and if you could also remember what Liz asked before, that the keep your questions quite short and that they aren't long statements. Then we can get through many more. So, this gentleman here. Thanks, Emily.
Hello. The first thing you mentioned about the basic card was that there was a stigma attached to using it. Would it have been better for them to have attached those conditional purchase system onto an existing debit card so that there's no stigma attached? Would that solve the problem?
I don't know whether that would solve the problem, but it would solve that particular aspect of the problem.
Because my understanding of the purpose of the card was to remove the discretionary purchase of alcohol and things like that, and to make sure that the children were fed, not necessarily to restrict what was purchased. You know, if they were making informed purchases, but simply so that groceries would be purchased.
That is partly true, but the problem is that just quarantining that amount doesn't mean the kids are going to go to school. Quarantining that amount doesn't mean it's not going to be, the remainder is going to be used for alcohol. So what it's doing is taking away things, leaving a remainder in the desperate hope that that will be used not for those other things. But also, they can only use it in certain shops. So, for example, Coles, Woolworths, and the big ones. What if they don't live near one of those particular shops in particular communities? What if they've got their own shop that they're used to?
Yes, that is in part true, but I think it's taking away discretionary income in a way that forces people. It doesn't teach them how to, in fact, manage themselves better. It's taking away all of this, saying you can only spend it there, using this card, and that's the only way you're going to do it, and you can't spend it on anything else other than what's in that store. I think that's depriving people of basic rights.
But isn't that the whole point of it all, for families that don't use the money appropriately?
Sorry?
That for families that don't use the money appropriately, if the if the male of the family chooses to use it for his own purposes, which happens in Africa quite often as well, rather than for the family. As you mentioned, women are much better at looking after children and ensuring they have resources. And if this mechanism does ensure that the children are fed, well, then it's fulfilling its purpose, isn't it?
Well, I've heard rumours that actually there is some trading using these basic cards, and in fact there is a putting it down for gambling. So I'm not sure that that's right. But my basic point is it's the taking away and the removal. Instead of dealing with the problem and say, this family's got an issue, let's find out a way in which we can get those kids to school. Give them additional payment, which is conditional upon that. And if they don't do it, they don't get that extra payment. You've got to have a carrot and a stick, but not just take money away and say, you can only spend it in this way and no other. I think that's taking away a basic human right. I don't know. I'll just see if there's other people that have got some other questions. If you'd like to follow that up afterwards, I'd be more than happy to do so.
Hi. I've just got an issue with the conditional cash transfers. Any principles of poverty alleviation should have self-determination and human rights at the principles and addressing structural causes of poverty. I was just wondering how is structural poverty actually addressed when you're essentially individualising kind of the issues of poverty by rewarding communities who behave in a certain way with extra money and not actually addressing how the inequality, like wealth distribution within that country, is actually produced with that government. I'm just wondering, isn't that just cherry-picking or picking non-deserving and deserving kind of poor there if they behave in certain ways? Just wondering some opinions on that.
Well, there's two things here. This is talking about how to deal with a very impoverished community that is dependent on social welfare. One can also add there needs to be other policies to try and encourage people into work and empower themselves. So I'm just looking at a fairly narrow band of how to assist the most disadvantaged to then ensure that there isn't intergenerational poverty because the kids aren't going to school, the kids aren't getting fed properly, whatever it is that's the target. So that's the purpose of the CCTs. It's not to deal with a much broader issue, and it's a good point that you make, which is the macroeconomic policies, which relate to, well, how do we get people into jobs? How do we encourage people that are lounging around watching television and not inspired to go out and do something, to go out and do something? That's a different strategy. And it may very well work in a similar way. You could say, well, look, if you go out and do that, then you can get a carrot. Carrots and sticks, on the whole, need to be worked in tandem. Is that in part answer your question?
My question refers to the CCTs as well. You reference CCT for school attendance. Does CCT for school attendance make the assumption that the education offered is relevant and addresses the needs of the Aboriginal students, which are vastly different to those of the dominant culture? And the second part of that question is, do you feel that the teachers going into, for example, the APY lands are trained to address these differences? I'm just wondering about the having the CCT when in actual fact the basic structure is not there.
The strategy, as I understand, is not CCT in Australia. It's actually taking away money. So if, for example, using the APY lands or Northern Territory, there is a real issue there as to whether the education that is being delivered is in fact really encouraging children to go there. And of course, the bilingual language issue. So I think there are some issues in Australia with regard to that, as to whether what is being required of parents to enforce children to go to those schools, whether in fact that is an education that really deals with their needs. So I agree with that.
I just wanted to ask for a little bit more information about the last project that you spoke on, which was in regards to sort of restorative justice within looking at a whole community, and the channeling of funds that previously would have been used to for the incarceration purposes, but putting that back into community. Is there a pilot project that's happening in South Australia or somewhere else?
No. In fact, this has not been rolled out anywhere in Australia. It's been rolled out in the US and Canada and about 17 states in the US. What is being planned here by a small working group that's only just started, it's in its infancy, is to in fact do some mapping to find some relevant communities where one can look at, well, what is the crime rate there, what are the needs there, and then work out what the cost is of incarceration of people that come from that community, and then what sort of services might be needed to be delivered within the community to deal with a particular group that it's relevant to. So that hasn't been done yet, and that needs to be done for the purposes of then running out a similar project.
May the force be with you.
I have a question about in the poorer communities, how important it is to eradicate the corruption before these programs can be delivered properly.
With regard to the ones that I have looked at, the ones that I've mentioned, corruption hasn't featured. Now, when I've looked at one clearly that's in the Philippines does not have a great record of corruption. In fact, it's got a very poor record, but that's not to do with this sort of money, which is very much done through the Philippines Commission for Women, and then it's done within community itself, and the money is given within community. I'm not saying it doesn't arise, but this particular program, particularly when it's been monitored by the Canadian group, I'm quite safe to say that it doesn't involve corruption. What happens in other countries, I can't say. But all you can hope is that when they've done their assessments, and the ones that were done in Mexico and in Brazil, they have looked at how much it costs to deliver the programs as well. So they've been monitoring it and looking at where the money's going.
Getting back to that income management issue in Aboriginal communities, has there been any study addressing the underlying factors of alcohol and other drug abuse there that to be addressed?
I'm sorry, I just missed a little bit of that. What was the... Could you just repeat that again?
In relation to the income management project and how bad it is, just I was asked...
Of where? From where?
In Aboriginal lands.
Oh, Aboriginal lands, yes.
Okay. Mm. Then has there been any study about the underlying factors of alcohol and other drug abuse in those communities?
Not that I'm aware of. There has been, going back a little, the Northern Territory Invention arose as a result of a very comprehensive report which was with regard to child protection. That showed all of the factors that led to child protection, which were in all of the matters that underscore poverty, the housing issues, etc., etc., etc. Some of those issues are being addressed with health. For example, there is improved health, but there is nothing that I know of that indicates that child protection rates are any lower. Nothing that I know of that indicates that in some of those areas that the alcohol or gambling has actually reduced. I don't know. If they are, they're not made overt.
Hello. Just really quickly, I was just to one big statement really quickly. I think that it's important that when we're making comments not to generalize in saying things about men in Africa and it being common that they do not appropriate their funds for their families correctly. I think it's important not to say things like that because it's not true. But to my question, thank you very much for your talk. I found it really interesting, but I just wondered, I guess coming from a community development point of view, you talked a lot about policies and how they work out in rolling them out to communities. What I would like to know is how active communities have been in making these policies successful. Have they just been recipients of it, or do you have examples of how these policies have been successful because the communities have actually come on board as well?
Yes, and in fact, the Philippines example that I gave was exactly that. It was where the community identified the need, it went to the great project, and then the great project helped bring it together to then make sure that the strategies that they wanted to bring together could be done. So it actually emanated from the community themselves. And in the Philippines, there is actually another excellent program which is done and inspired by women, which is working on the Grameen Bank example. So there, it's called the Negros Greater Futures for Women project. That's now developed some 56 banking facilities for micromanagement of to assist micromanagement for women in their enterprises, and also bringing about not only credit access but social inclusion policies, which include social security payments, payments for education, they can borrow to do certain things. That was all developed by, with and through communities of women.
Thank you. Well, I'm afraid there isn't time for any more questions. So thank you, Robyn, for a presentation of great breadth and depth, and I'd like the audience to please join me in thanking her for a wonderful presentation. I'm sorry, I didn't introduce myself. My name is Denise Skiffington, and I'm branch president of Amnesty International in South Australia and the Northern Territory. And this is actually towards the end of the evening, but I just thought I should let you know who I am as I deliver my role. Very shortly, I'll be delivering the vote of thanks. But before I do that, I'd just like to draw on a couple of the threads of your presentation, Robyn. That poverty is a global issue of enormous proportions that requires both global and local initiatives seems clear. That those people who suffer most from poverty are Indigenous communities, both in Australia and in countries overseas, and they are women. The fact that 1 billion people will go to bed hungry tonight is a human rights violation, I think, of shocking proportion. And I think sometimes the enormity of the issue can be quite paralysing for us. Sometimes it galvanises us into action, but sometimes it paralyses groups into what, in terms of what they can do. And I think the good stories and the good practices that you related to us tonight, many of which is informed by the work that you've done with communities, I think gives us great hope that there is a possibility for change. But I think one of the important threads that links all of those good examples that you gave us was the centrality of community involvement, that if communities aren't involved at every step of the way, then the long-term effectiveness of these things just simply does not work. I think other things that you have talked about that are very much in keeping with the way Amnesty sees poverty is that it's not just about lack of resources and it's not just about needs, but it's about things like deprivation, voicelessness, powerlessness, exclusion and insecurity. And it's about the human rights violations that drive and deepen this. And the way that Amnesty sees poverty, very much reflected in your presentation tonight, is that while foreign aid, foreign investment, investment in new technologies is all very important in addressing the issues of global poverty, unless human rights is absolutely front and centre to what those programs are, then there'll always be a limitation to the success and the long-term sustainability of those. And I think it's very important for us to remember that protecting the human rights of those in poverty is not an option, that it has to be absolutely essential and is part of the solution. So now we really do come to the sort of end of the evening where we thank those people who've made this evening really possible. Events like this don't just happen. And so in her absence, I will thank Auntie Josie for her warm welcome to country, to our distinguished guests and to the general audience. Thank you for showing your support for human rights by being here and by being a very participatory audience. To Monica Morgan, who's travelled from Victoria to be with us tonight, and I know at a time of great personal and work pressure, thank you, Monica, for being with us. Thank you to my Amnesty colleagues for their support this evening. To Liz Ho and to Louise Carnell for the Hawke Centre for their very generous collaboration again. We did this for the first time last year and the year of Amnesty's 50th birthday, and delighted that we were able to work with you again this year. And finally, thanks to our speaker, the Honourable Robyn Layton. Robyn, your commitment to and passion for human rights and social justice is very much in evidence. Thank you for sharing that with us this evening and for your generosity in giving up your time, which I know is incredibly precious and where your talents are on great demand. And so I would like you to accept a small gift in our appreciation from Amnesty International.
Thank you very much.
Thank you very much.